Hey fools, Jason Hall with the Motley Fool here, with Andrew Littlefair, CEO and co-founder of Clean Energy Fuels.
Welcome, Jason.
Thank you so much. Appreciate you having us here today
and
sitting down with us. Before we really talk about Clean Energy Fuels, I'd like to talk a little bit about your experience before Clean Energy Fuels, and which was Pickens Fuel Corp before that, right, with Mesa, and a little bit of time with the Reagan administration.
Right. So I grew up in Southern California. I went to University of Southern California, and but I was kind of a political animal. My first job was in the Reagan White House, and I spent about 1983 to 87 as an advance man there, political appointee.
Okay.
And then I left there and became a Boone Pickens assistant. So I left Washington, D.C., moved to Amarillo. And I had an expanding role there at Mesa. We were, as you may know, Mesa was a large producer of oil and gas, mostly natural gas.
Right.
And we had a lot of natural gas. The price of gas was very low. And so Boone's idea was, well, we get a nice upgrade on our reserves and we can move it in the transportation sector. But that was a long time ago. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's 1990. So we were on the kind of the cutting edge of that. But I was involved in that. And then in 97, when Mesa was recapitalized, I came back to California to start Pickens Fuel Corp. So with Boone's money, I was the only employee. And we started acquiring some stations. Our largest franchise was from Southern California Gas Company. And so for the first few years, we operated as Pickens Fuel Corp. We sold out at one point 75% of the company to BC Gas, which was the largest utility in Canada. And then Boone bought back that 75% in about 2001. Oh, maybe it's 2003.
Okay.
And so I've been here from the beginning.
Right.
And that's kind of how I've all worked. And my political background was important. Early on, you know, natural gas as a transportation fuel was really an environmental play. And mm-hmm. so it really, and it didn't have very good economics in those days. And so that's why Southern California made sense. And my political experience helped me kind of navigate the policies that were promoting clean air stuff.
Right.
That's less important today, but that was kind of my background.
At that time, oil was almost single digits a barrel, right?
I tell you what, the month we opened Pickens Fuel Corp, so I think I'm right on this, right, in 1997, oil was $10 a barrel.
Right, right.
And so we were selling natural gas at the pump at 87 cents a gallon, but gasoline was a dollar, mm-hmm. I don't know, 20 or 10. So
right.
The economics weren't there like they are today.
Exactly, right, absolutely.
So it was really environmental. Mm-hmm. We were burning, in those days, burning much cleaner, dramatically cleaner. We still are cleaner on carbon, and we're still better at the tailpipe. We don't have the carcinogens that like diesel has and the toxicity. But gasoline and diesel has gotten cleaner in 2007 and 2010. We're still cleaner.
Right. Nonetheless, the tailpipe emissions for natural gas are still
noticeably low. Much cleaner.
Right, right. So a lot of the past few years, the focus has been on America's natural gas highway,
right,
and heavy trucking, beginning to make,
right,
that shift away. And even as that's taken time to really start kicking in, I,
right,
think one of the things that doesn't get enough attention is what's happening with the core business. So,
right,
if you could talk about what's happening.
Sure.
There.
So, we always focused on fleets. So sometimes people look at us and they think of their experience as, a passenger vehicle. That's not really. We fuel a few thousand Honda Civics at our network in California and some other places, but really we're fleet focused. So when we started the business, we really got serious about refuse trucks, transit buses, and airports.
Mm-hmm.
All those vehicles go to airports. So those, what we refer to those as our core markets, and that's,
right,
what you're talking about.
Right.
And so that's our bread and butter, and that's grown over time 20-some-odd% a year.
Mm-hmm.
And there's ups and downs in it, but let me give you an example. Today, about 35% of all the transit buses in the United States are natural gas.
Mm-hmm.
And we went through kind of this period a few years ago where people were talking about fuel cell buses and diesel hybrids, and that's kind of gone away, and you're seeing a resurgence in natural gas transit buses. And the reason is, like, LAMTA today is 100% natural gas here in Los Angeles.
Right.
2,200 buses. They save about $60 million a year.
That's
on
significant.
Fuel. So that's really significant.
Right.
And so the life of that bus, I mean, that's getting up to almost $800 million. So it's real money. And a lot of transit properties are figuring that out. The other core business that's been exciting to us is the refuse business.
Mm-hmm.
And, we started that. I mean, it started out almost 10 years ago, or longer, 12 years ago, with 7 converted waste management trucks.
Right.
No economics. The incremental cost was $150,000. It was brutal. I mean, we took a diesel truck off the road, and we had to take out the engine and change the transmission, and I think the incremental was $135,000,
$150,000. Wow.
But in fact, he's with our company now. He had the Western Region for Waste Management, Ray Burke. He understood that he was getting points with the franchises to operate these cheap trucks.
Right.
But it wasn't easy, and the economics were suspect. And then if you didn't have grant money, it was very difficult. Mm-hmm. Well, over the last decade, we went through about 4 different engines. But it wasn't until 2008 that Cummins Westport really came out with that great 9-liter engine that had really the torque and horsepower very similar to what a diesel engine was capable of, and you didn't have the big efficiency penalty that you had in previous engines. Mm-hmm. And so in that year, which I think is interesting, Jason, in 2008, there were 5,000 new trash trucks sold in America, and the 9-liter came out. And in that year, these guys tested it. Okay, they were game, but they were suspect because they'd been through some engines that didn't work so good. And 150 trucks were sold that year. Mm-hmm. This last year, 60% of every new trash truck sold in America, 8,000 new trucks, about 60% of them were natural gas. So that's our core market.
Right.
We have 75% of market share in that market. Mm-hmm. We've had competition from time to time, but we've proved out because I think we have the experience. Back in 2008, I think we had 6 or 7 companies that we worked with. Today, we have closer to 200. We have
a little growth there.
A little growth, and we're operating refuse stations. We built 30 some odd last year. We'll build another 30, 40, this 35, I think, this year. Mm-hmm. People are operating natural gas trash trucks all over the country,
right?
In New Hampshire and in Florida and all over. I think maybe we're operating refuse stations in 30 some odd states right now. Mm-hmm. So that's exciting. Waste Absolutely. Management, of course, has been a great leader there. Last year, 95% of all their purchases were natural gas. Republic was a little behind that, but they've shown great leadership at about 65%. We have 4 national agreements with the largest refuse guys. So Waste, Progressive, Republic, and the 4th one always escapes me, but I should. But we do a lot of business in that sector. So the core market is alive and well. We could use more product for the light duty stuff. We've struggled a little bit with taxi cabs. But when you drove in here this morning at John Wayne Airport across the street from our headquarters here, all those taxi cabs are natural gas. And in San Francisco, all the taxi cabs are natural gas. So that market continues to grow. Shuttles and shuttle buses. We now operate at 39 airports in our core market. We're building some more right now. We just opened Kennedy Airport. We got a big one going in right now, Chicago O'Hare. But that's a nice market for us. We don't have much competition. Mm-hmm. And in that market, we're selling. We have nice margins. We own those stations. We're selling against gasoline and diesel.
Right.
And we can save those customers $1.50 a gallon. Mm-hmm. So which is meaningful.
I think one thing that could potentially, there's actually 2 things that could potentially continue to help that part of your business grow. Chevrolet's got a new Malibu.
Yeah, CNG. Yeah, I think the Impala.
Or the Impala, right.
Which could be a great taxi cab.
Right.
Because we've been struggling on that. Mm-hmm. We had the Transit Connect from Ford. So the Impala would be great.
Right, right. Plus Delphi and Westport now have an OEM agreement.
Yeah.
And there's potential for that to, go downstream.
Well, you'll see more and more of it.
Right.
Seen, this is still niche for the big OEMs, but you're seeing more now. You know, the F-150, mm-hmm. Ford is preparing that engine.
Right.
So that could be very good for municipalities and others.
Absolutely.
And so you'll see more. The new Ford Transit, they're getting away from the old Econoline van, mm-hmm. and they're coming out with kind of something, a bigger product that looks more like a Sprinter van.
Yep.
That'll be on natural gas too. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we have high hopes for that. And I think you're right. I think that people, we've talked a lot about the America's Natural Gas Highway and heavy duty trucking. And let me just mention this. So, in our core markets, if every transit bus in America went to natural gas, that's about 1.5 billion gallons annually.
Okay? Right.
And then airports is about 2 billion. Okay. So, there's a lot of work to be done still in those areas. Mm-hmm. And refuse is about 2 billion gallons. Okay, so you roll that all up and call it 6 billion gallons. Heavy-duty trucking is 30 billion gallons.
Right.
So it's five times bigger. So that's, I think it's appropriate for us to focus a lot on that because it's a very big market. But our other markets alive and well and doing well, and we continue to grow. And right now, this year, on what we call our carpet, which is our construction carpet, the mm-hmm. things that are underway, we have about a total of 48 core stations under development right now that'll get built. If they don't all get built this year, it'll be very close to all
right.
getting built this year.
Right.
And so it's a big part of our business. And one of the things, and you may ask me about this later, I can go into more detail, but one of our advantages is we have a compressor company. Mm-hmm. And so most of the core markets that I've talked about are CNG.
Right.
There are a few exceptions, but not many. So most all transit buses are CNG now. Everybody's figured out that's right, the way to go. And same with the refuse trucks. Mm-hmm. And so we're able, for instance, to sell our equipment into Waste Management, and we sell our equipment into Republic. And so it gives us an advantage.
Well, it's, you know, I'm glad you brought up IMW, and we'll definitely circle back. I think
sure.
there's definitely some value there, and I'd like for you to add on to that.
Right.
But in terms of that core business, I think it's also good for people to understand that it's not just about fuel delivery. Obviously, that's the most important part of
right.
it. But as I understand it, your business is also about servicing and maintaining stations.
Right.
So for Waste Management, for example,
right.
you know, they produce a fair amount of biogas that they use themselves.
Right.
But that doesn't preclude you necessarily from being a business partner with those situations.
No.
Can you talk about that?
Yeah, I will. One of the things in the refuse business and sometimes in transit, and I think it gets lost sometimes and maybe doesn't sound so sexy, is in certain of those markets where certain customers, and certainly customers that are well-heeled customers that have great access to capital. Look, Waste Management's got more money than we do, right? And
right,
they
right.
figured out a while back that it made maybe more sense for them to use their capital to build a station. Mm-hmm. So they hire us to either build a station and buy our equipment. So that's good business for us. And then we have an operations agreement with them. So we operate the
right.
station for several years at a time. Obviously, less margin.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly less margin on transit because transit properties are getting funded 93% by the federal government. So, you know, they don't need our capital. They have free capital,
mm-hmm.
but they do like our maintenance. So
right.
So we fuel. We may not sell the fuel in every case. In many cases, we don't mm-hmm. in transit. But every night we fuel 7,000 transit buses where we operate those stations. So
right.
we get a maintenance fee per gallon. And when people look at our blended, I think sometimes it's misunderstood when they look at our blended gallon. We'll in our earnings report we'll talk about our margins per gallon. You have to remember that. You have some retail,
mm-hmm.
certainly in trucking and in airports where it's higher margin. And then you have a lot of gallons, like in transit. We sold almost 100 million gallons last year where it's a thinner margin.
Right.
But no capital and
right.
no risk. So
right.
now in terms of the biomethane, you know, we have a renewable business here.
Mm-hmm.
And people's, I think, over time, what are you guys doing? And I was slow to recognize its importance, and we've really
this is redeemed.
This
right?
is
right.
redeemed, and we call that that the division clean energy renewable fuels. We refer to it as SERF, but it's in house here. The reason we got into the business is, as you correctly point out, the waste guys own the landfills,
mm-hmm.
and they love the idea of taking their own gas and putting it in their trucks. It's really a closed-loop system.
Right.
One of
right.
the guys, Bob Coyle, who is a Waste Management guy, has said it's environmental nirvana. And so they asked us to get involved in that, and
mm-hmm.
that's why we did. So our customers really wanted us to get in it.
Well,
so,
it gets back to that core strengths.
That's right.
Right.
That's
their
right.
job is going out and removing things people
that's
don't
right.
want, and your job is
that's right.
dealing with the fuel.
That's
system.
Right. And you know, that, I think our advantage over some kept competitors, we have a lot of the pieces.
Mm-hmm.
So if that's what the customer wants, we can do it. So we're cleaning up gas at landfills now, and
right.
we're sometimes it goes to power generation.
Mm-hmm.
It's 90% less carbon. It's really renewable, but a lot of it now is going into vehicles. And as you mentioned, last year we launched our clean fuel called Redeem.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this is really a 90% less carbon. That's really the cleanest commercial fuel available, really in the world. The stations that we have here in Southern California are most of them are using Redeem. We sold really more renewable fuel last year than anybody else in the United States, about 15 million gallons. So it we see a great potential to use Redeem for some of our heavy duty fleets.
Mm-hmm.
These trucking guys, and specifically the shippers, we refer to the shippers as being the companies that hire truckers. Mm-hmm. Okay, so Procter & Gamble would be a good example.
Right.
They really pay for the fuel, and not the trucker. The trucker passes the fuel cost on
right.
to the shippers.
Right.
But they also have, importantly, they're all consumer companies, and I'm talking about Home Depot and Miller Coors and all these kind of companies. They all have sustainability programs.
Right, absolutely.
And they've changed a lot of the light bulbs, and they've replaced their plants with cactus and stuff like that. You know, they've done some of the easy stuff, but really they can't do anything that's just get a big bang for their buck. It's by asking their haulers to use natural gas first, and then if they can start to blend in Redeem, it really is significant.
So it shrinks that carbon footprint.
Oh, it's huge. It's huge. And in fact, I think I'm right on this. I'll be a little risk here, but one of the big home improvement centers has an aggressive sustainability target, and I think by just asking 10% of their hauling to go to mm-hmm. Redeem, it would satisfy that for 2020.
Wow.
So it's pretty powerful, and at the same time, you're saving money.
Right, right.
So we have high hopes for that, and we're cross training all of our national team right now so that they understand how to sell Redeem and make sure the customer understands its value.
Right, right. Absolutely. Because, I think in terms of having bigger impact, as you said, to wider sustainability
right,
goals that
right.
your average person might not associate with anything to do with trucking.
That's right.
These goods have to get to the store somehow.
They do. And, I was a little surprised, Jason, that the sustainability, of course, I've been in the environmental end of the business for a long time, but I was kind of surprised that the sustainability goals are as potent as they are and that these companies are taking them as seriously as they are. And, of course, that's good, I think, for everybody, good for public health. And so we have a fuel, just regular old natural gas, or this more sustainable natural gas, mm-hmm. Redeem, that is really a benefit.
I think the stigma that green costs more money
right.
has finally started to fall to the wayside, and businesses are understanding that.
Yeah. It doesn't always have to cost more money.
No, not at all. Not at all.
We had some policies here in Southern California that 10 years ago from the good leadership of South Coast Air Quality Management District, the fleet operators were required to run natural gas if they had a fleet of a certain size. And, there was some squealing about that at the time. Then it became clear as the engine technology advanced and the price of oil went up, You're asking people to move to a cleaner fuel, and it's a lot cheaper.
Right.
So you're not putting anybody out of business.
Right.
You're actually saving them money. So,
yeah.
And I tell our political friends upon occasion, you can make money and do good and also be green. I mean, those things aren't mutually exclusive.
Not at all. Not at all. So talking about the economics of fuel, a popular misconception, you've addressed this numerous times, but for people that may have not been following
right.
The story for very long. If you can talk a little bit about how the commodity costs
sure.
Of natural gas versus diesel
sure.
and oil, how does that work?
No, I think it's a good question because people you read. In fact, I was listening to CNBC this morning. They're talking about how natural gas has gone up dramatically and therefore it can't compete with coal and all that. So let's take a couple steps back. Yeah. Natural gas versus oil. If you were to burn them, just a BTU basis, they should trade at about 6 to 1.
Okay.
Okay. So what does that mean? Well, that means if you had make it easy. If you had $100 oil, natural gas on a BTU equivalency should be around 15 or 16 bucks an MCF. Okay. But you sit here today with
per
oil,
unit of energy.
Per unit of energy.
Right,
okay.
Right.
Hey, but you sit here today with oil, banging around $100 a barrel and natural gas, I think this morning is $4.37 on the NYMEX. So you're seeing something where the spread is dramatically different. For years and years, oil and natural gas traded more like 7 to 1 or 8 to 1. And today they're trading more like 20 to 1,
right.
22 to 1.
Right.
All right, so what does that mean? Well, that means today natural gas has a huge advantage, the commodity does versus oil.
Mm-hmm.
So when you look at it in our business, here's the way, and this to me is the most important piece. And when I'm talking to investors, I always make I know it sounds like, you know, Henry High School, elementary, but I always want to make sure they understand it. So you get 8 gallons of gasoline equivalents. Okay, would you think
for that $4 and change is worth 8 gallon
equivalent? Yeah, exactly. Right. So right. 437, so you divide by 8, so the commodity today, to take that car, this, you know, do you have the energy the same as a gallon of gasoline? Your commodity is 53 cents. Okay.
Okay.
Now, without getting into all the detail of how the margins build up, but you know, you have to do some stuff to it. All right. So right. You got to compress it, and you've got to pay for the gas from the local utility, and you need a compressor on it, and you do O&M and maintenance, and so there's cost in there. But you're at the nozzle tip dramatically cheaper
right.
than the competing fuel. So today in LA Basin, gasoline's $4.19. We're selling natural gas at our, we have 60 stations here in Southern California. We're selling CNG at, kind of depending who you are and where it is, about $2.50. So,
right.
So the customer is enjoying almost $1.70 a gallon savings. So it's dramatic. So you do have economics today. So here's the way to think about it, because people are saying, well, the summer, the fill season may put pressure on natural gas. Natural gas could go up and maybe go up as much as a dollar in the summer, which usually would be not normal, right? Usually you see the price of gas go down, but you had a cold winter and storage is low.
So they got to build back up.
They got to build back up. So, right. But anyway, so let's say there is a dollar. Well, a dollar, when you divide by my 8, see, it's 12 cents.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so it's 12 cents. That's easily captured in that big spread that we see.
Right,
today.
Absolutely.
So, you know, the oil and gas industry would love to see $5.50, and really, that doesn't affect us. Do we love $3.50 gas for what we're, of course.
Right.
But
the reality is that's not sustainable, but it doesn't really impact the business.
It really isn't. So we're – and when you see these we saw some very high gas prices for a couple days and maybe even a week during the winter. Remember, we're usually buying it a month at a time on a utility tariff ahead of time.
Okay.
So we're – in just like a hurricane season, used to see spikes in natural gas price. We don't really see that.
Right, right.
We could at our plants where we're buying pipeline gas and making LNG. But we have the opportunity, if we see a spike coming, or if there is a spike, we don't buy that much that day.
Right.
And,
right.
So,
do you anticipate once the LNG kicks off, and you know, and you start building out the facilities with GE, that you'll be using any kind of hedging?
Well, we talk about that a lot at the board level. We actually even have a hedging committee. You know, I think the market has been clear with us, and investors have, but they're not wild about us going out there and speculating.
Right.
All
right.
So. You know, I think probably the answer is we've hedged before when we line it up with a customer contract, and we actually have then we can treat it as hedge accounting.
Right.
We probably won't see us out speculating.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, I could envision a day when we're doing a lot of contracted volume with UPS where you would hedge.
Right. Because of the terms of that contract that you need
right,
to hedge to.
Right. But you'll you'll hook that up though with a particular customer contract.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
Yeah,
that definitely makes sense. So again, just to kind of summarize the whole pricing factor, based on today's $4 and change,
right?
It's about 50 cents is the actual cost of that commodity, in the pipeline today. So
that's
there's
right.
a whole lot of fudge between that and before it gets to the nozzle tip. Even if natural gas were to double, you're still talking a dollar for the commodity cost.
That's right. And then so let's just say the cost is another buck.
Mm-hmm.
So now you're at $2 versus
right.
$4.19.
So it's basically about 12 cents a buck is what it.
That's what it is on the
commodity side.
On the commodity. So there's a lot of room here. That's why people say, well, you don't think you're always going to have, you know, $4 gas. Well, no, but I'm not so sure. Jason, here's the other thing that we could discuss, and everybody has different views on it, is you're awash in natural gas in the United States.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I'm in the camp that believe you have enough natural gas to export some of it and use more of it for manufacturing. We got a lot of it.
Right.
And it's really kind of breathtaking. I mean, I think when I was at Mesa, 10, 15 years ago, I mean, the America had kind of a rolling 20-year reserve life index of natural gas. And I think today you're closer to 150, 200 years. So,
right. So
you're going to have a lot of, I think, inexpensive gas relative to oil.
Mm-hmm.
And the country's done a great job on oil too, but you're exporting product that's keeping some pressure on it. So So yeah, I think we're in a nice position. Where I was headed was, are we always going to have 450 gas? Maybe not. Are we always going to be 22 or 23 to 1 versus oil? I'm not so sure.
But it doesn't have to be.
But it doesn't have to be.
Right.
In fact, it was kind of interesting at our port, in the port of LA in 2008. We were just getting going with some of our trucking down there, our big station. And we had $140 oil, and we had just about $14 gas. And so that's 10 to 1. Mm-hmm. But when you have $140 oil, guess what? You have $5 and 40 cent diesel.
Right.
So remember right. And so we had some of our largest margins ever, and it was 10 to 1.
Right.
So I feel pretty comfortable that the economics are here to stay.
Right. Absolutely. Let's shift over to the ANGH, America's Natural Gas Highway.
Sure.
And talk a little bit about what you guys are seeing with LNG uptake. You know, from everything that we've seen and heard in the industry, with the Westport Cummins engine,
right?
A lot of those shipments for the 400 horsepower, which really wasn't available until the end of the year,
right?
Didn't start happening until early this year. So
that's
a lot
right.
of testing in fleets. What are you hearing? What are the early adopters telling you? Where do you see the demand curve?
Right. So, you know, and of course, as you know, as you follow this closely, there's been a lot of discussion about CNG and LNG. Mm-hmm. And I've tried to be really consistent on this. We do both.
Absolutely.
And in the heavy duty trucking market, and even in America's Natural Gas Highway, you're going to have both.
Right.
Now, we built a bunch of LNG stations, but keep in mind, of the 24 or 5 that are open as we sit here right this second, we got a couple more coming right now to open in this next week or a little bit, I guess, about the next week. 16, I believe I'm right on the 16 out of the 25 or so, have CNG as well.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So we're not pigheaded on this. We understand. We need to sell what the customer wants.
Right.
And I remind people that, you know, we sell more CNG than all of our competitors combined. We built more stations last year than almost all of them, I think, probably combined. Mm-hmm. We fuel down in Florida, the largest deployment, Saddle Creek, who's been shown great leadership. CNG trucks, we built that station. We operate it for them. We fuel CNG trucks, big fleets of them. We just opened one yesterday at Sellersburg, where I have a beautiful picture of a bunch of CNG trucks coming through. So we know it'll be both. We also know that CNG is going to be particularly well suited for urban environments.
Right.
So this kind of last
mile. Where there's already infrastructure in place.
Yeah, because the like here in Los Angeles, Southern California Gas Company over decades has spent billions of dollars making sure the distribution system is seamless and good.
Right.
And so, you know, that's pretty hard to beat, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because otherwise you got to build an LNG station. So for urban environments, return to base fleets, distribution centers, you know, in urban environments, I think a lot of that will go CNG, and we're building some of those now. Longer haul in places where there may not be natural gas, where truckers are not necessarily returning to home, that are slip seating. You know, sometimes a trucker goes his 10 and a half hours and then somebody else gets in there and takes it the next. We think LNG is going to have a lot of play there.
Yeah.
But these are going to be both are going to be very big markets.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the way I look at it is, remember, it's 30 billion gallons.
Right.
And if it goes kind of the way I think it's going to go here in the next several years, if it follows anything like, and in fact, I don't even show that, if it just does about half of what the refuse industry did, you're in 2017, 2018, we're talking a few billion gallons of fuel annually.
Right.
And CNG and LNG will have big, big players. Mm-hmm. And so for our company, it'll be very important. We sold 217 million gallons last year. So in those years, like 2017, if the adoption goes the way we think, and really we're not talking about hundreds of thousands of trucks. We're talking about tens of thousands out there in a few years after people get experience. That's every year it's throwing off three or four times what we did this year.
Right, absolutely.
And so it's meaningful for us. And we have our eye on that ball, and that's what we're doing. Now, on the America's Natural Gas Highway, our job one is to open these stations, right? So you correctly mentioned that the 12-liter engine from our friends at Cummins Westport, really 400 horsepower engine, really didn't get produced until about August.
Mm-hmm.
And it takes a while. By the time, if you're a trucker, you order that thing and it goes through the dealer and it gets made, it goes to the factory and ends up in a chassis, and then it gets delivered to you and you put decals on it and everything. It takes a while. That's right. About a 4-month process. Right. We're just beginning to see these trucks roll in now, and that's why we're beginning over stations. You know, if there's a criticism of us, it was that, well, we built some stations a little bit too early. And
nobody else was going to do it.
No one else was going to do it, but you don't want to be, you don't want to die on the beach on that. Right. But on the other hand, and there was a good offshoot of it, we really changed the paradigm.
Absolutely.
The discussion between the truckers and the shippers, it was pretty easy for a good contract carrier to say, hey, Mr. Shipper, I'd like to do this, but there's no stations. But we've kind of changed that because, you know, we have these stations out every 250 miles down the I-10, the I-40, the 95, and the 5. So, you know, is it a perfect network? Of course not. But it's really changed the dialogue between those shipping companies and these consumer companies and their haulers. The engine was delayed.
Right.
So I don't want to pick on my friends, but, it was when we kind of cooked this plan up, we worked on it with our friends at Cummins, and that engine was really supposed to be here almost a year early.
Right.
So that's all right. This, I think, is the most successful launch of a new product that they've had, is what I think I've been told. Knock on wood, it's working well. Mm-hmm. And so it took some time to make sure it was right. So those engines now are coming. And so we got a little ahead on the station build, but they're there.
And they're starting to open now.
They're starting to open now. So job one for us this year is to open a bunch of those stations.
Right.
And we'll try to get a majority of those open. We'll also, where necessary, we'll add CNG, either LCNG at those stations or CNG. But that'll be customer driven.
Right.
And we're doing that now. And we have 5 LCNG, LNG stations that'll have CNG at them, and we have 5 of those underway right now. So now, I think part of your question was, what are we hearing, what are we seeing? And so today we have 220 LNG fleets that we're selling fuel to.
Okay.
Now, some of them are small, some of them are big.
Right.
Okay. And we have about 140 CNG fleets, and we're seeing a mix. It looks to us, and it looks to, I was listening to David Demers, CEO of Westport, the other day. It's breaking down around 50-50, 60-40. Mm-hmm. But we're still real early in this.
Right. And a lot of that's driven by fleets that are testing CNG is accessible.
And CNG is pretty accessible for a fleet. Right. If you're here and you want to try a couple CNG trucks, that's pretty easy. Mm-hmm. You may go to a station that wasn't really designed for you.
Right.
But you can still make it work. So you're seeing some of that. And I think some people have been drawing some conclusions based on pretty skinny numbers.
Right.
And we're seeing we have some big LNG customers, right? UPS is one of them. UPS is currently now fueling at 7 of our stations. And they've got several hundred more trucks to take. And we're bulk supplying them in some places where they don't actually fuel with us. But we're providing
supplying
the fuel.
Gotcha.
But we have other big fleets like CR England and Dillon and Raven, who hauls for Miller Coors, and NFI, who hauls for Lowe's. And so these are big LNG customers. They're serious logistics operators. They know what they're doing. And a lot of them are trying LNG, and some of them are also trying CNG.
Yep. So we're seeing stations 2 to 3 a month opening right now.
Yeah, I'd love to tell you that every month I'm going to open 3 stations. My goal is we have about 60 stations that need to open.
Right, they're built and just ready to turn the key.
They're ready to turn the key. There's not really any other CapEx that's required. There's about a $10,000 commissioning kind of thing we go through. We have to put some fuel in it and all, but they're ready to go. Mm-hmm. And our job around here is to get the majority of those open this year. So, yeah, you'll see it's a little lumpy. We're waiting for these trucks to deliver, but you'll be seeing them kind of open in 2s and 3s. And the nice thing is, once we do that, there's a couple things that happen. So you're opening them when you get probably 20 trucks, mm-hmm. usually, and that's the way you should do it. And then once you open the station in Amarillo, Texas, for instance, then you begin to work the area. Now people can try 1 or 2 trucks.
Right.
And so we our sales team's doing both, right? Mm-hmm. We're trying to base load these stations, get them open, and then we also go to work on broadening the fleet base at those particular locations. The other thing that happens, Jason, is we're beginning over time here, and you'll see it for the next several months, other segments are opening up. So, you know, we're opening up when you do Amarillo, then you're
somebody in Amarillo that's going somewhere
else. Going to Albuquerque, right. So it's beginning to happen. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of exciting.
Cool. That's great. That is definitely what we're looking to hear.
Yeah.
No doubt about that. So one thing that happened recently that was surprising, kind of exciting, was the acquisition of the CNG and a box units from Chesapeake Energy.
Right.
Can you talk a little bit about that and your plans? And,
sure. Well, you know, we had a long, healthy, deep relationship with Chesapeake. Mm-hmm. Chesapeake loaned us money. Mm-hmm. They were great supporters of natural gas and transportation. They had a big operation themselves. Aubrey McClendon was a visionary, I think, in this, and, mm-hmm. And a friend of ours. They, though, shifted gears after Aubrey left, and they had these to really get GE in the business. They had put in a big order of these CNG in a box from General Electric. I've been telling people, Jason, because it sounds kind of quaint, like CNG in a box, like it's in a two-drawer cabinet.
In your garage.
These things are big. Okay, so they are self-contained. They're a good unit. They have the storage. They have the dryer. They have a 400 horsepower motor, and it would be, look more like a container. So these aren't little things. They're mm-hmm. kind of big things that are really well suited for truck application. So we got 65 of them. Bought 65 plus the dispensers. They're ready to go, and we're beginning to deploy them now. They're well suited for a new exciting vertical for us is the ready mix vertical. I'm becoming a quasi expert on that, which hardly. But because of the downturn in construction and all a few years ago, really the ready mix cement truck industry hadn't added any cement trucks.
Right.
And so they got pretty old fleet out there, and mm-hmm. and a lot of pent up demand. So we have the product for them now.
With the Cummins Westport engine.
Yeah. And you're seeing them very seriously look at their, you know, they're not, if you think about it, they're not totally dissimilar to a refuse application. A little bit different profile. They don't always work the same in the winter, but
you still have that same return to base model.
Yeah, they go out and they fill up and they go back and they stay in one place a little longer. But they don't quite use an average refuse truck in the United States uses 10,000 gallons a year. I'd say ready mix a little less. Mm-hmm. But they're in clumps, and there's more ready mix trucks around than you would think.
Yeah.
The CNG in a box that we have is really good for them.
Okay.
Because really nicely suited for 15 or 20 trucks. And what happens is, in some cases, refuse trucks, ready mix trucks might be at a location where there are a couple hundred of them, but then they have satellites in other parts of the city where there's maybe 20 of them. And so you'll see our GE in a box, this is CNG, mm-hmm. Go into that market. It'll be used in the refuse market for smaller fleets. It's kind of interesting, Jason. What you're seeing right now is in the big guys, Waste and Republic, and this is an overstatement, but a lot of trash trucks in the U.S. are in clumps of 100 or 150. So here in the L.A. Basin, there's a bunch of those where there's 150. Maybe they service a couple different cities. Mm-hmm. But then there's probably half of, and my number is 100, there's like 180,000 refuse trucks in the U.S., and about half of them are in small places.
Right, where you may have one or two or five or 10 trucks.
You may have 10 trucks.
Right.
You may have 12 trucks. And it's pretty tough to make $1,500,000 station pencil for them.
Right.
The GE in a box may be a solution for that as well. And then the GE in a box is going to be good at starter fleets for CNG heavy-duty truck fleets behind the gate.
Right.
So it'll take us a while to work them off. We purchased them right. We have a deep relationship with General Electric, and this is kind of the fourth thing that we're doing with them. So we're excited about those, and they're beginning to go in. We won't wipe out 65 of them this year, but I see it as an advantage too, because they're built and they're sitting there and
they're ready to go.
And otherwise, if you go out and order a compressor right now, it takes a while.
Right.
And so I think it'll be an advantage for us.
So as compared to what IMW does, this is kind of a niche that IMW doesn't specifically.
Well, you know, IMW has a product that that is we've retooled IMW, so we're pleased with that. We have some new products. So we have a complete fleet fueler that is a self-contained package. Mm-hmm. And I would say that you know, my friends at IMW, they say, "What would you do that for?" Because they want us, obviously they want to sell us a bunch of this stuff. The GE in a boxes have, if you put two of them together, three of them together, because we bought them right, it's kind of hard for others to compete with us on that. If you were just going to go to a bare bones, self-contained smaller unit, IMW has a unit that would work for that as well. So. We think that by putting, I didn't really mention that, by putting a couple of these G unit boxes together, you have 400 horsepower engines, kind of large, is a unique offering that maybe IMW didn't have.
Right. And it was an ideal opportunity to acquire these units the way you were able to get them from Chesapeake.
Right. That's right. And I'd rather have them than have somebody that wants to run around in the truck market. With those. So.
It's either you or somebody you're competing against. So.
That's right.
Sounds like it was.
That's right. No, I think it was a good thing, and there's good equipment. We're working closely with GE to even optimize them now.
Great. So let's talk a little bit about IMW. How important is IMW outside of supplying, you know, clean energy directly?
Yeah, you know, because I get that question some, and I think it was a little. I got the question more often when we had BAF, which was our conversion business, and mm-hmm. we had stuff in Peru. And as you know, we sold BAF last year to Westport.
Right.
Others are in that business. We didn't really need to be in that business now. Mm-hmm. We needed to be in the business when BAF was in a difficult financial situation. We needed product. And
right.
We have stations. If you don't have if you didn't have BAF, you wouldn't have natural gas taxicab. Mm-hmm. So I think we were in it at the right time for the right reason.
Planting seeds.
Yeah, we're planting seeds and filling up our stations.
Right.
And without their product, and BAF did a really good job working with Ford and developing a full line, which Westport now has kind of incorporated into their West Wing technology. But they did an excellent job. They did an excellent job of selling thousands of units into AT&T, and we fuel about 50 or 60% of those mm-hmm. today. So that made sense for at that time. But others are in that business. Now, so people used to ask me, well, do you really need to be in the compressor business? Because other people are in that business too. Well, we buy a lot of compressors, and so we see it as strategic. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have, if you look at this business today, there are about we have about 95 competitors.
In the compressor business?
In the refueling business.
Okay.
Now, people say, oh, come on, there's not that. Well, some of them are pretty small, and some of them are kind of regional, and some of them really don't have any experience. But there are about 95 companies out there that say they're in the CNG business. And I don't want to stand in line with them
waiting for
a compressor.
Right.
So for us, I think it is strategic. We're buying about 30 or 40, 35% of IMW sales. But natural gas fueling and transportation is happening around the world. Mm-hmm. Probably faster than it's happening here.
Right, absolutely.
We took our company public in 2007. I remember at that time there were about 5 million natural gas vehicles in the world, and today it's closer to 17 or 18 million. So a lot's happening in a lot of places. Mm-hmm. And we're asked all the time to go into different places. And really, you know, look, we're in a great sandbox. We're in the best market here in the United States. Mm-hmm. We're one of the biggest fuel markets. And so we try to stay pretty focused. However, IMW is asked all the time to build stations around the world. So it kind of allows us a way to participate globally in this. And we know more about this fueling than just about anybody else. And so IMW is selling today to about 26, 27 countries. Mm-hmm. We have a big deal in China right now. We've built a couple other stations in China already. We don't own them.
With China Gas?
Yeah, with China Gas.
Right.
We signed recently a deal with Russian Machines to do a similar thing in Russia. But we're selling equipment today in Vietnam and Egypt and Mexico. And so it took us a while to get IMW kind of squared away. Mm-hmm. It's had a little bit of growing pains. I remember when I made the first deal with IMW probably 10 years ago, 12 years ago. In that year, they were producing 12 compressors. and we bought six of them. And I think this year it'll be closer to 300 or 350. So we've that business has grown a lot. We've retooled it some. We've got some new management in there. We've beefed up our sales. We really, until recently, that's why I mentioned on the last earnings call, we like what we see there. We really were taking orders around the world, not really selling.
Right.
And we can do better than that. So we've got now a new sales organization, IMW. It's important. The business can be much larger than it is. Mm-hmm. And I think, importantly, we buy a bunch of the equipment. So it gives us an edge others don't have.
So it sounds to me like, besides the obvious advantage of letting you be first in line when you need equipment
right.
for your own needs,
right.
Lets you participate in other markets
that's right.
without pulling away from the core resources that drive
that's
the
right. And, you know, in a lot of other markets, and we've looked at other markets. Right? I've sent yeah. a couple of my guys. We looked at India. They want us to come there. And we've looked at Thailand and stuff. But, you know, in a lot of those places, the government owns the resource. Mm-hmm. And they set the price. And you know, we don't have any business building and owning stations in Russia on long-term contracts and trying to figure out if we're going to get repaid.
Right, right.
But selling them equipment,
it's a different story.
That the Canadian government guarantees, because mm-hmm. the IMW is based in Canada, mm-hmm. you know, that does make some sense.
Right, right. Well, you mentioned Russia and the deal with Russian machines recently, and it's all over the news what's going on with
right.
the Crimea and the Ukraine. And initially, there
timing's been, everything.
It really is, and so the question is, how do you see if the path goes, you know, down the road that there are sanctions that are placed that actually affect businesses? What's
right.
what's that impact on?
Yeah, well, I don't know if we'd be picked up in that or not.
Right,
And I'm not clear on what sort of sanctions will be done. And obviously, if there's some, if it's forbidden to business in Russia, that won't be good for our business.
Right.
But I think we're probably a ways from that. Mm-hmm. The opportunity there, working with Russian machines and their related sister companies, is our partner there is wanting to do much like we did here. There are three or so corridors, large transportation corridors, running out of Russia into Eastern Europe. They really want to set those up on natural gas. Mm-hmm. They're already making natural gas buses there.
Right.
Our partner is. Our partner's already making natural gas kind of jitney trucks, smaller truck than we have. So I think there's a great opportunity there. Now, if there's a broad sanction where you can't do business with Russia, you know, we'll get caught in that. I doubt we're going to be kind of at the top of that food chain, and we're selling equipment, and we're not owning resources there.
Right.
I would guess major oil companies or something would get caught up in this mm-hmm. before we do, but I don't know.
So worst case scenario, it may limit some upside.
Well, and I guess worst case scenario, it'd stop it.
Yeah.
until things got stuck, got sorted out. But we see it as a, you know, this is not an overnight thing. This is going to take a while.
Right.
And we think we've got an edge over others there. We've, a couple of the large gas suppliers there, Rosneft and Gazprom, are going out to bid, it looks like, for a bunch of stations.
Okay.
I like our chances there.
Right.
So you know, similar. If this all got caught up in politics, then I don't know what that would be.
It is what it is. It's uncontrollable.
No, I can't control it.
Right. So the deal with China Gas, if I recall correctly, was around $150 million
right.
in opportunity over a 3-year period.
That's right. That's right.
Do you anticipate more international opportunities like that for IMW coming up over time?
We have a pretty good series of deals working right now. I don't know if we've announced them, but one in Australia.
Okay.
We're seeing these things pop up mm-hmm. in different places. Turkey, we just put in our first station in there. We have, oddly enough, we've got IMW employees in Colombia. And in Bangladesh, where we built stations and we actually operate them there. So there's a lot of opportunities like the China Gas. Now, China Gas is bigger, we like that one. We'd like to do more deals like China. With China. There are other companies like China Gas in China where we would like to see if we couldn't get them down to get with them as well. We're working hard to get the deal flow. China kind of ebbs and flows once in a while,
right.
So it's a little lumpy. But we're beginning to see those compressors come through now, and we push on them as hard as we can to get it faster rather than slower.
Right, absolutely. Let's shift over to talk a little bit about competition,
sure.
Especially domestically. One area of competition that seems to be getting a lot more traction is CNG competition, especially from utilities like Questar is making some serious moves. Integrus through their Trillium CNG.
Right.
What's your view on the competitive landscape against utilities expanding into this? It's a new market for them. So,
you know, they were in it once upon a time. All right. So back, if you roll back to the late 80s, and in fact, Warren Mitchell, our chairman, who was chairman of the Southern California Gas Company, they did their first natural gas vehicle business in the 60s. So this isn't completely unheard of.
Right.
But they were all the America's utilities were in this business in the 80s. So in that day, it was Lone Star Gas in Texas and Brooklyn Union Gas and Southern California Gas, and they were building stations, but they were early. Mm-hmm. And they were thinking light duty.
Right.
And
right.
So it didn't work.
And like you said before, the economics were very different.
Were very different. People forget, though, we had a war in there, you know, mm-hmm. So you did have a fly up in oil prices in 1990. Right. The OEMs were making cars. I mean, Ford, GM, they were all in the business, mm-hmm. Chrysler. Then oil prices went down. Pressure kind of came. The Clean Air Act got passed in there, so there was pressure on the environment. But then things settled down. We went through sort of a deregulation period, and electric companies bought gas utilities, and a lot of them got out of the business. We were beneficiary of that, right? So we bought the 30-some-odd stations that Southern California Gas had. We acquired the ones in Colorado. We bought the ones in Texas, the ones in New York, as they left the business. All right, now, fast forward to today, they're looking for business, right? Things have gotten more efficient in terms of things that use natural gas and electricity, and so they're looking at this as a market. I like competing with. I buy a lot of gas from these guys,
right?
But I don't mind competing with utilities. Utilities are really good at providing service. They're not so good at being entrepreneurial, and so I have a little bit of heartburn when utilities are wanting to use ratepayer money to get in this business
expand.
And compete. You know, look, I just told you there's 90 some odd companies in this, and I probably have to back out 10 utilities. There's what's called 80 some odd. So normally utilities aren't allowed to compete. They're a monopoly. Mm-hmm. They're not usually allowed to compete when you have private sector companies in the business. And they don't do plumbing, you know, they hire plumbers. And but some of the regulators have allowed them in some of these instances across the country, there's a handful of them, where they're allowing them to kind of do test programs using ratepayer money. I'm not a big fan of that, right? Mm-hmm. So what that means is a particular utility is going to use their customers' money and get a return
on it.
Get into this side of this business and compete with private sector.
Right.
I have no problem with utilities doing what they ought to do and what my friends at Questar have done and Integrus, where they've set up a unregulated subsidiary. Mm-hmm. And typically, and it's always a little different, typically, though, that subsidiary is responsible to their shareholders, not their ratepayers.
Right.
All right. So they're taking shareholder money and they're putting it in there. Now they're competing with us, and I think that's fine. Mm-hmm. We've competed with Trillium Group. 15 years.
Yeah.
Now they're owned by
Before they were acquired by Integrus.
They used to be owned by Wagner and Brown, Boone Pickens' old friends from Midland. So we used to compete with them in the transit business, and they tried it in the refuse business. So we know them. They're a good competitor. They're doing CNG.
Right.
So I don't really have a problem with that. Now we have Southern California Gas is trying to use ratepayer money in kind of a way that they're trying to get in it. You know, I think what happens often with utilities is they don't really have a sales force. Mm-hmm. The regulators aren't going to let them go unrestricted on using ratepayer money. And so what you often hear is they're going to do things like spend $5 million or build 8 stations or 12 stations. And a lot of times I think what happens is it confuses the market. Mm-hmm. Look, utilities using ratepayer money have cheap capital. There's pretty people. And they can bury stuff. And those are big companies. I'm not too worried about it. They're regional. Mm-hmm. The unregulated guys, the guys out of Utah, Questar and Integrus, they're trying to be more national. You don't have many examples of that.
Right.
And so I'm not too worried about it. I guess if you were to look at competition, When we start talking about heavy-duty trucking fleets, some want to do LNG. Most of the utilities don't do that. Mm-hmm. Most of them have a hard time if now you're talking about doing in multiple states. So, you know, there's room. It's a big, huge market. We'll compete fine with them. So I don't see that as some big threat.
Do you think?
But there are a lot more competitors in the business today than there once was.
So you think when it comes to utilities, your core strengths, especially in terms of your larger scope and size and being able to go in different places.
In many different places, answer a fleet that has maybe in multiple states. Utilities mm-hmm. can't really do that.
Right.
Do LNG, they can't really do that. They don't have a compressor company like we do. Mm-hmm. They don't have a sales force. We have 100 sales.
Right.
They don't have that. So what they rely back on is kind of getting cheap money mm-hmm. from their ratepayer and perhaps cross-subsidizing that.
Right.
And you know what? That'll be successful for a little bit, but that I don't think that's typically sustainable.
So additional, you know, competition, and I think this is probably the primary competition you're going to deal with is, you know, private companies like Blue LNG gets, you know, a ton of their funding from ENN Group.
Chinese.
And you got, you know, Travel America and Shell that, you know, announced almost a year ago that, you know, they were going to open some stations. Chart Industries just recently announced they have a contract to build 20 LNG stations for a major oil company. Maybe that's Shell, maybe not. I don't know.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to tell.
Yeah.
Well, let me speak to that, Jason, because it's one that I think people get a little confused over in this. And let's talk about this heavy-duty trucking market. Mm-hmm. If I were in here telling you that I was focused after the consumer market and I was going to build all these stations, now I'm competing with the major oil company. And I think you'd have to look at me suspect a little mm-hmm. bit because they have the real estate, they have the refineries, they have that market, they've been there forever. However, on the heavy-duty trucking side, it's different.
Okay. Right?
So there's 118,000 gasoline stations, more or less, in the United States. There's about 5 or 6,000 diesel depots
right.
in the U.S.
Filling up big trucks.
And a lot of that's behind the gate, right? It's in some guy's backyard. When you begin to draw down and you look, think of truck stops, it's a different animal. The major oil companies are not in that business, never been in that business. You may drive around someplace and see a Shell canopy at a truck stop, but Shell doesn't own that.
Right.
And may not even supply the, probably doesn't supply the fuel. So so often people say, well, gosh, you know, Exxon's going to wake up and they're going to do all these truck stops. Exxon just got done selling their last 5,000 gasoline stations. So I have a hard time imagining that they're going to now
get into the retail
truck stop business.
Right.
And when you think of truck stops, you think of Pilot Flying J, our partner. They're the largest in the business. They have 550 locations. They're selling somewhere around 10 billion gallons of diesel of that 30 billion gallons a lot gallon
so
market.
So it shows right there the scale of that relationship.
Yeah. We think it's really important. We're good partners with them. They've shown some patience as we've been built these stations, and we're all waiting for some more trucks to roll. But if Pilot Flying J said they were going to compete with us, well, then that would be, I would worry about that. But they're our partner, and they're our exclusive partner. And then you'd kind of drop down from them, and you have some other very fine, large truck stops, Travel Centers of America and Love's. They're kind of the next biggest ones. And they're somewhere around, both of them are about half the size of Pilot Flying J and 250 locations. But when you put those three together, you're covering a lot of the
market. About two-thirds of the market between those
three. It's hard to get your arms around this. I've heard different numbers, but that's the idea.
Right.
And a lot of America's trucks, some are fueling in their backyard, and a lot of it's retail. And, you know, for instance, Pilot Flying J, they're doing something like, and this may count submarine sandwiches too, but they're doing like a million transactions a day. So you don't want to go out. I mean, that's where the trucks are going.
Right.
And you don't want to go out and reinvent that at all. Now, in regards to Shell and Travel Centers of America, look, this is a big market. And so I think when Shell announced, I think it's closer, almost a year and a half ago, maybe, or even more, that they were going to get in this business, to me, and their mighty Shell has to pair off with the second largest truck stop firm, Travel Centers of America. Mm-hmm. That validated to me that we had the right idea.
Right.
Now, they've been a little slow to move, I think, and I believe they're getting ready to open their first station here in Southern California. There could be two of them.
Right.
So we'll have 100 built or so before they
really get to two.
So, you know, are they a competitor? Sure. Do they have a lot of capital? Yes. Do they have LNG today in Southern California or in the United States? No.
No.
So they've got some work to do. They don't have a sales force. They don't. They're not in this business. But I think it kind of validates what we see. I really don't think you're going to see. I think the competitor someday could be the industrial gas guys. Now, right now, they're customer.
Okay.
So Linde, Praxair, Air Products. You know, they're very good at moving fuel around. It might be different kinds of cold fuel, but that's what they do.
Right.
They're typically in stationary environments. They're bringing nitrogen to a plant someplace, and they build the equipment of the plant. So it's not too dissimilar from what we see, but it's a different market than one that they've ever been in.
Right.
They're actually running some of their trucks, and Lindy's a good customer of ours, running some LNG trucks right now. Hmm. You know, someday could you kind of paint a picture where maybe they would build some LNG plants and maybe supply us? I kind of see that. I don't know that I'm going to see them, Lindy, putting in truck stops.
Right. Again, it's about their core business.
It's about their core business.
Right.
And they're a little slower than that. But I think the industrial gas guys are potential. I happen to think that if a company like ours or some other companies got big enough, I mean, if this really goes the way I think it's going to go, and then you're selling billions of gallons, now maybe you get a major oil company show up and say, listen, we got natural gas. We understand this. That makes sense. Maybe we just buy the whole thing.
Right.
Right. But I think they'll let us go through a little bit more brain damage and difficulty before we get to the size where it would be meaningful for a company like that.
Right, right. Now, I think you get to a key point right now is because this is still in such its infancy. And the fact that you know, still the vast majority of that diesel is still diesel and will remain diesel for years.
A long time.
Yeah.
That's also why I usually get the question about our margins. Mm-hmm. You know, okay, Shell builds a station, and all of a sudden, that's going to collapse my margins. Well, wait, this is a pretty big market, and remember, we're competing with diesel. Mm-hmm. So I don't care who our competitor is. I don't envision a time right now in this kind of infancy when we're talking about hundreds of millions of gallons or even a billion gallons when you got 30, 40 billion gallons out there using something else. I don't know that you and I are going to go compete with one another and drive ourselves down to no margin, but allow the competing fuel diesel to be $2.50 a gallon more than us.
Well, I think
it's, so I don't see that right away. Right. Someday we will have margin compression.
Of course. But when that day gets here, there's a lot of good
diesel will be coming down too.
Absolutely.
At that point.
And just looking historically at the oil and gas industry, big oil doesn't lose money.
You know that, funny how that works. Yeah,
right, right. So I think your statements in terms of margin compression are fair. You know, big oil makes money. These are profitable companies.
Well, and
they're your suppliers today.
Could your margin get under pressure at some point when this gets to be more of a prevalent fuel? Well, sure, it will, and that's okay.
Right.
Because there's some room there. Mm-hmm. The other thing that'll happen that I think tends to maybe offset some of that margin compression is, remember, today I'm giving my customers $1.50 a gallon savings, or more in some cases, a little less in some cases, but generally around $1.50 a gallon savings. I'm doing that because they're working off an incremental cost on the price of the truck. Let's just talk about the trucking of $35,000 or $40,000. Now they use about 20,000 gallons a year, so you're trying to get this to about a 1 year payback.
Right.
But when the price of that truck comes down, like it has already, you know, the first 9-liter trucks that came out that we tried to put in heavy-duty application a few years back, they were $65,000. Today, it's closer to $25,000.
Right.
So we've seen them come down, but I think that you'll see the $35,000 or $40,000 for like this 12-liter with one tank come down as well. Mm-hmm. And let's say it comes down to somewhere around $20,000. Now you're really at 6 or 7 month payback. I'm not so sure that you need to give the customer a 6 month payback.
Right.
And so there may be some movement in reducing, because you're not working off such a high incremental cost, reducing that savings. At the same time that maybe our margins come under a little pressure. But I think you're a little ways out.
Right. Absolutely. It's a few tens of thousands of trucks that need to be sold before
that's right.
becomes a. So let's talk a little bit more about the partnerships that, you have, especially Mansfield and Pilot Flying J. You know, we've heard a lot about the ANGH and your relationship there with really the big boy when it comes to the retail side of the fuel for the big trucks. We really haven't heard much since the Mansfield, you know, partnership was announced. Can you tell us
more about that? In fact, we were all working on that yesterday. We have a good relationship with Mansfield. We kind of what happened there was they had a natural gas fueling business. Mm-hmm. We acquired that.
Right.
And it had some distribution rights for home refueling and all this. We have all that now. And they had about 20 some odd projects underway. We finished those. The largest of which, and so they're kind of in our account now. Mm-hmm. And the largest of that was El Paso Transit. Few big stations there. They're just now being finished. But the real opportunity there is, and Mansfield Oil is a great company. And Michael Mansfield's a great leader there, and he's had tremendous growth. Mansfield, a private company, they're backlot fueling. Okay, so when you think of our Pilot Flying J relationship and their depth in kind of retail truck stops, 10 or 11 billion gallons, some big number like that. Well, Mansfield is behind the gate, and they're more like 3.5 billion gallons a year. Kind of put those two together.
That's a pretty significant.
So the real opportunity for Mansfield was not so much the business that we acquired and some of that stuff. It's the ongoing relationship. Mm-hmm. We just signed a deal. I just sent out a congratulatory note, a deal yesterday with one of their customers. The transition is underway. Our sales forces, and there's more work to do here. Our sales forces are now making joint calls, joint referrals. Mm-hmm. As their customers move, look, as their customers, we've sent some diesel customers, and they're sending us leads on natural gas customers as their customers transition. So, a little early to tell what happens, but we do know an awful lot of customers fuel in their back lot. Mm-hmm. And when they're ready to go to natural gas, Mansfield seamlessly brings us clean energy in to do that, and we both share in that. So now we have a kind of a new deal with Mansfield that is important, and Mansfield is a leader in bulk fuel hauling.
Okay,
hauling gasoline and diesel around.
Right,
and so they have a lot of reach there. We see that kind of like the ready mix is another vertical. With a partner that has, I think, 900 trucks every day working for them, and just about every hauler works for Mansfield already. So we've got two stations underway on that. And so these will be building natural gas fueling stations at bulk fuel haul terminals with our friends at Mansfield and trying to go after that market. So that's kind of exciting. So that's new. And you haven't heard much about it yet.
Right.
We're gonna walk a little bit before we start talking about it, but we have two projects underway right now with them.
Gotcha. Okay. So to me, it sounds like a lot of what's going to happen with the Mansfield deal is the same thing that's going on with all of the shippers out there. The conversation they're having with the truckers is going to affect Mansfield because those are their customers.
Yeah, and the reason Mansfield got into the natural gas thing aggressively is because they provide a lot of the diesel to waste management behind the gate, right? And Republic. Okay. And so we're in there getting that.
Right. Right.
So that's what got them interested in.
They see the way the dynamic is shifting, the way the
future's going. So, you know, it's going to take a while to a lot of their different behind the gate fleets move to natural gas, but I think we've set it up so that when that happens, Mansfield's still in the business, in business.
Right.
And they're our partner. But, so, you know, we're early there on the backlot fueling for those other kinds of fleets, but they have a lot of good long-term relationships.
Great.
So we're pleased with that relationship.
Good. One of the other partnerships that's been around for a long time informally, and it was definitely formalized earlier, we talked about BAF when you guys decided that the right thing to do is to sell that to Westport and formalize a marketing agreement with Westport.
Right.
Can you talk a little bit about how important that partnership is? How has it helped Clean Energy Fuels?
Sure. Well, you know, we've had a relationship with Westport since the beginning, mm-hmm. right? So Westport, through BC Gas and all, had an investment in clean energy. David Demers, our CEO, sat on our board.
Right.
And I sat on Westport's board. Mm-hmm. So we've had a long relationship. I mean, let's face it. Without their leadership and without their good technology and some of these heavy-duty trucks, we didn't have anything to sell, right?
Two legs on the same stool.
Yeah, so we've had a long-term relationship with them. We've gone in and I think it was Westport and Clean Energy convincing Kenworth that we could put these engines in their truck for the first 100 that we had to buy in the Port of L.A. So we've had a long-term relationship with them. I have a very good relationship with the board at Westport and with their CEO. Our marketing guys, the president of Cummins Westport was in here just last Thursday. So we do lots of work with them. Now on the BAF side, we're trying to harness, because we have all these CNG stations at airports and all, and they're mm-hmm. selling products. So mm-hmm. Peter Grace, who runs our sales effort, works with Westport, the old BAF unit, to try to do what we can to help on their sales. In fact, the guy that we brought in to run BAF is running the sales now at the Westport in their conversion business.
Gotcha. For the whole wing business.
Yeah, for the whole wing business. Yep. And we like him a lot. We hired him. And he's a good guy. So, yeah, you know, without engines, they don't buy fuel. So we try to help all engine manufacturers, right? I'd like to have more engines. So
right,
I don't rub Cummins' nose in that. But, you know, the fact is, I'd love to have Navistar come with its own engine product and Volvo coming. I mean, that's all good for the business. It's certainly important for us as a fuel provider. So we work with really all the OEMs, a lot of the body manufacturers, the conversion guys. We have to because we're a beneficiary.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So the GE partnership is really interesting because it's not just a single partnership.
Right.
The LNG project, the partnership that's been in place there
right.
a couple years ago.
Right.
And then more recently, the finance arrangement. Let's talk about the LNG project first. What's going on there?
Yeah. Okay. Well, we love our relationship with GE. And GE is kind of all in. I mean, from the CEO down. Mm-hmm. Is really all in on natural gas. I had no idea, really, until I got more into this, the extent to which General Electric worldwide, the revenues come from natural gas. So, you know, they're doing turbines and mm-hmm. measuring equipment and downhole stuff and
right.
and compressors. And, you know, they're really committed to natural gas. So they're an important partner for us. So the first deal that we did with them was the LNG plants, right? So where they're willing to finance two new LNG plants for us. And we've done a lot of, that was about probably a little over a year ago. We've done a lot of work on the equipment side and on the location side. Mm-hmm. We're working with GE on this. They're willing to loan us a couple $100 million and we had to put up the rest. So that's important. And it's important to have their technical help as well. We've kind of got those locations picked out. I'm not ready to tell you exactly where those are, but they'll be close to the load center, mm-hmm. right? And so that's kind of Midwest to Northeast, right? It's interesting on LNG plants. People don't always understand this. You really need the LNG near the load center, not more than about 250 miles away.
You have to move it.
Because you have to move it. So, you know, people will say sometimes, well, Cheniere, well, why don't you just buy all your LNG for Cheniere? Well, that's good if you're down there, but it's not so good if you're in Boston. So, but we're going to make sure we're not going to get ahead of ourselves in these plants. I want to see this truck, a little visibility on these truck orders. And we're fine right now on LNG, right? We have some plants, as you know. We have two plants. We take all the product from a third. We now have 13 sourcing agreements at peak shavers around the country. If you were to kind of put your arms around all the LNG that's available today, in the U.S., that surplus that you can use for transportation is probably 800 million gallons annually.
So it's enough to support your ramp up for
years. Well, we've sort of got our arms around 400 million.
Okay. Right? Okay.
And that 800 million was, you know, those are for peak shavers. Remember, those peak shavers this winter got a little bit of work out. Mm-hmm. So anyway, you're good, and we are well positioned for the next couple of years. But these plants take 2 years to build. Mm-hmm. And if it goes the way we think, by 2017, you're out. I mean, you'll need more. And there's been good news on this front, right? I was at the World LNG Conference not long ago, and there's a lot of people talking about building, you know, building LNG capability. There's been a few plants announced. So I feel like the industry is going to respond, but we got our eyes on it close. I don't want to go spend money earlier than I have to for these LNG plants, but I recognize why I need it. So we probably won't get a lot of capital committed this year on it. We're going to do some work to be ready to pull the trigger. We have, and that GE finance relationship, we have this year to begin to pull the trigger and get it built.
So I think it's probably fair to say that the second half of 2014 is probably going to tell you a lot about...
Yeah, we're going to see how these trucks roll out, right? You and I are both watching that closely, is we need to see how these trucks roll out and how much of it's LNG, and we'll see. And we don't need to get too far ahead of ourselves, but we like that. So that's one GE deal. The other GE deal, I think, is probably we'll look back on, the industry might, and see that it was one of the most important things that happened is the GE finance relationship.
Yeah, please expand on that.
So, you know, up until recently, no one was really willing to give you, if you're a truck owner or a guy buying a truck, a residual value of your truck. So, right. You know, you didn't know what it was worth. Mm-hmm. Well, so that's kind of hard to buy something when you plan on turning it back in 3.5 years and you don't know what it's worth. All right. So that was a wrinkle. And until GE stepped up and said, no, we'll give you a residual value and we'll do a fair market lease, vehicle lease, no one had been willing to do that. I think that may have been the last obstacle. Look, we have a lot of natural gas. We have kind of the network in place. We've done a lot of education. We now have the 12-liter engine, but we didn't have a finance mechanism like the way these guys buy trucks. So I imagine, so we've now cross-trained. If you can imagine, GE's a big company. They have 100+ guys that do nothing but finance trucks, heavy-duty Class A trucks.
Right.
They're working with our guys. We've now developed a big list of we've done a couple deals already. We've got a whole bunch in the pipeline. They go through an application process. And kind of the way it works is if they agree to buy fuel from us, we'll help offset a portion of that lease. That's kind of it in a nutshell. And you're still borrowing your money from General Electric,
right.
But if you buy fuel from us, then we'll help make it. And if you end up using like most of these guys do, you can get it down, buy it down to where there really isn't much incremental cost at all on this lease versus a diesel truck. So
the
it really takes the risk.
Get that return on investment is close to day one as humanly possible.
Yeah, take the risk out of it for them.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
So that's an important piece. And then we have a third GE relationship, which is a GE Eagle partnership.
Right.
And this is a partnership between GE, Ferris, who's an industrial gas to
the folks up in Canada,
and ourselves. Now, this is to develop LNG plants for the oil field, for marine and rail.
Right.
So it's kind of outside our core business. Mm-hmm. But if, for instance, our first project that we're trying to land desperately is for marine down in Jacksonville, Florida, if we were able to base load with a shipping company there, see, it would then open, we would take volume out of that plant to open up the peninsula of Florida and be able to sell it into trucking.
Gotcha. Okay.
So that's kind of the theory on that. The companies are staffing it and funding it. We're looking at rail, marine, and we're busy on. So that's really the third GE piece.
So that's interesting you bring that one up because the folks at Westport on their most recent earnings call were really excited about the potential for rail. Seems like the demand is even stronger than they anticipated. So it sounds like
I hope so.
This new, I guess it's kind of a consortium that you guys have.
That's right.
Opens up more opportunity for some of the rail stuff.
Yeah, think about the connections here. So GE makes they make a locomotive.
Yeah.
So that's kind of handy. You know, it's interesting. What we're told is, and the rail guys I think believe this, as trucking goes to natural gas and they begin to really save, rail needs to too.
Right.
And you know, I think Warren Buffett has been pretty clear that he wants BNSF, which he owns, to take a leadership position in this. Currently, clean energy is involved in fueling BNSF, CSX, and Union.
Oh, really?
Okay. So we're already in it, neck deep in it. But, you know, these are big companies. Absolutely. They've been around a long time. They have long life assets. I mean, a locomotive is supposed to hang around for 30 years. They move pretty slow. They've been around since the mid-1800s, right? So I think there's very strong interest. They're all testing it. They don't do things rash. Mm-hmm. But the volume's big. And, I mean, you'll literally have to build an LNG plant at every yard.
Yeah,
big yard.
Right.
So, you know, how that eventually plays out, I don't know. You know, I could sort of envision that maybe the rail, they may pair off with a major oil company.
Right, just because of the scale.
And because the majors have the gas reserves, you know, the capital, mm-hmm. the big companies. You know, so we're in there now. We're in there fueling. We've done a lot of work with them, and we'll be involved. But I don't know exactly how that's going to pan out. But they use a lot of fuels, billions of gallons. I think BNSF buys a couple billion gallons themselves.
Right.
And right. So these are it's exciting. And it should be exciting for Westport.
Absolutely. I know they're working pretty closely with Canadian National Railways as
yeah.
well. So,
yeah.
So there's definitely a lot of opportunity there for
right.
sure. So let's shift over and talk a little bit about debt and talk a little bit about capital allocation, kind of what you're saying.
Sure.
In the latest 10-K annual report, there was a new paragraph under risk factors,
yeah.
Specifically talking about debt.
Right. So our debt's gone up, right?
Of course.
And it's in that, you see, it's $600 million or so. Let's kind of peel that back, though, and remember what we got. So you got a couple hundred, about 290 million dollars of that convertible debt that can be satisfied with stock.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now, obviously, we don't want to do
as
that.
As a shareholder, that dilution, yeah, right.
Yeah, so you don't want to do that today. You want, you know, you hope you do it at a much higher stock price. But just so that you don't think we're just, you know, looking
right.
at demo.
It's not a bankruptcy call. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's a big slug of it right. to be satisfied that way with equity, if you wanted to, if the circumstances were right.
Mm-hmm.
$50 million of that debt is not recourse to us. So it resides down there at SURF.
Okay.
So that's to those projects down there. So
this is the renewable.
It was our renewable business. Right. So fully half of that debt is not doesn't concern us as much.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have the recent slug, another couple, $250 million, which is from that recent convertible that we did.
Right.
Now that's out there a ways. So that's mm-hmm. out there about 5 years. So you know, nothing really comes due for 2.5-3 years. And then five years, and some of it can be satisfied with stock if we had to, and $50 million of it you have to take off the table. So we're kind of comfortable now. Has our interest payments gone up? Yeah, and does you know we've got to work on making sure that we've got money to pay it, but you know we're very focused around here to make sure that we can service the debt and have plenty of money to grow. And obviously, if VTAC were to come back in, that's $50 million that would be nice to have. That's the volumetric excise tax that went away. We've had it before.
And then came back.
And it's conceivable that it's going to get reinstated later this year, in which case you've just covered the debt payment. See what I mean?
Right.
If not, we'll get it there. It's really through the volume growth that we'll be there. Mm-hmm. It's more difficult this year, but as these trucks roll out, we feel comfortable. We feel comfortable that we can handle it. So now on the capital side of the equation, because there's been some discussion on this, we're sitting on about $365 million of cash. And in our recent earnings call, I think. We said that sort of the maximum amount of capital we would spend this year would be $135 million. You know, we're going to try to really watch that closely. We're not going to get ahead of ourselves and build a whole bunch more stations if we don't see the trucks coming.
Right.
We don't necessarily have to spend. We had a piece in there for our LNG plants. Well, we may not get that spent this year. In fact, there's nothing that says we have to put our money in first, right? So that's another.
If you are spending that money, it's a good thing because there's demand.
That's right. That's right. So, I mean, I always feel that this is kind of a high-class problem, right? If you're building a whole bunch of stations because you think you're demand, we don't need to build a whole bunch more stations and have not open. Yeah. So that we won't do. But when you pair some of those things back, you can really get yourself around to where the capital program for 2014 is closer to $80 million than $135 million. Mm-hmm. And so the way we look at it is you got plenty of capital, even with this increased debt load, plenty of capital for 2014, 2015, and out into 2016. And our view is by then you see the volumes by 2015 and 2016, you're going to be comfortable that you're having a really strong cash flow. You still may need more money, right? Again, it's a high-class problem. You may want to build another few hundred stations, and you'll need more money, but you ought to be able to, at that point, to avail yourself to more normal-looking debt. Mm-hmm. I think that'll be the case then. And some of that, the converts, by that time, I think will be gone.
Okay.
So we're pretty comfortable as we sit here. We look at a pathway of having capital for the next 2.5 years, and we think that matches up pretty nicely with the way we see this volume going.
So in terms of capital allocation, the best way to sum it up is you've invested significantly in, I guess you could almost say, speculative building, creating a network that would change, like you said, change the conversation between the shippers and the truckers. And essentially, when you're allocating capital moving forward to opening new stations, it's because you know there's going to be specific
demand
for it.
That's right. I mean, you know, first off, we didn't just put those stations in because we
found. On a wild guess.
Yeah, we have non-disclosure agreements with a whole bunch of these big shippers, and we know where they trucks go.
Right.
And that's why we picked the locations that we picked. Did we get them in a little early? Yeah. So were they?
But they're where they need to be.
We think, you know, there may be one that we didn't get exactly right. But we think we know that's where the trucks already go because they're already going by in the diesel fuel.
Right, right.
But were they a little more speculative? You know, for years we wouldn't spec a station. And that in the core business we don't.
Right.
So, you know, you go broke doing that. So mm-hmm. we get that. Mm-hmm. I think some people have been gotten a little wrong, you know, that these 60, 70 stations that we built, well, that was somehow a company that we bet the company. That's not the case. I mean, you know, we have the capital to make adjustments in that, and so, you know, we've spent a lot of money over the years on infrastructure development, on having LNG plants, and we have the first purpose-built plant of LNG in California, and that thing is at about 75% full. Okay, that was pretty speculative when we did it, but so. You know, we feel like the bet that we made on the America's Natural Gas Highway is going to pay off. And that it was, you know, do you want to go double it up right now? No, probably not. And in the future, and this has always been our theory, is you're going to begin to infill that public retail network, the America's Natural Gas Highway, with stations that are built, purpose-built, because the customer wants it. So you're going to be putting, for instance, I don't want to get ahead of myself here, but we know there's 11 Miller Brewery plants where beer moves every day and has to. And you'll put stations, if we can work out to deal with them, at each of those breweries. Mm-hmm. But they're base loaded, right? So they're not speculative. So we've kind of done the network of what you suggest is a little bit more speculative. We don't need to continue to do that. Mm-hmm. And you'll infill it with customer base loaded stations.
That makes sense. And then as these stations begin to open, some of the smaller truckers are going to now have the opportunity to start playing as well.
That's right.
So there's a lot of different metrics that can be used to look at a company. One that I follow pretty closely with, you know, companies that have spent and invested a lot to build out is looking at cash flow and positive cash flow. How do you see Clean Energy's cash flow situation changing over the next few years?
Well, so, you know, just let's just kind of go back and think about the let's just talk about the heavy duty trucking market, okay? And I'm going to make some assumptions here and show you what it can mean for us. So let's say that just to keep the math easy, that there's 10,000 trucks, 12 liter trucks, come on board this year.
Okay. Okay.
I don't know if it'll be that many. I mean, maybe a little bit less than that, but let's just use it because it's an easy number. Well, they'll on average use 20,000 gallons. So that's 200 million gallons. All right. I'm not going to get into it exactly, Jason, but we have a pretty nice margin in there today because of the price of gas and all. Substantial margin, and it's closer to a real retail margin than it is
the contract margins
I was talking about earlier.
Right.
And so we'll have a significant market share in that. And so we can debate that. Is it 70%? Is it 50%? But let's just say that 200 million gallon run rate is going to be created just with 10,000 trucks.
Right. And that 10,000 number is a good target. That's what Westport and Cummins are.
That's a number we all know. We don't have crystal ball, but we know it could be 8,000. It could be, it could be in there. It could be more. Who knows? But, they're prepared for that, I think. That throws off, may not all come to us, but that's going to throw off about $100 million EBITDA. Mm-hmm. And if we have a big, significant piece of that market share, which we will,
right?
You can see we're pretty close.
Moves the needle. Yeah.
It moves the needle for us dramatically. So you run that out. Look at the metrics. You run that out a couple of years where you start taking up to 20,000 trucks. You're adding more gallons every year than we sold in the previous year.
Right.
In some cases, two times, three times.
Right.
So for us, it's really, what metric do you look at? It's really volume. Mm-hmm. Right. And it's my market share, and it's making sure we don't lose our edge. And we've shown over time that we can have pretty good margins, and sustain those margins. We have 39 airport locations where we have really healthy margins. And people say, well, gosh, for the competition, well, I don't know where I don't. We've been at it 15 years. I don't know where they've been. Right. So I would say metric for us is volume and our market share, and then you just have to make an assumption that I'm going to be able to get some sort of margin there. Mm-hmm. I think the other thing, as you think about what metric is, I don't need 1 million trucks.
Right.
100 trucks at one of these truck stops does 2 million gallons a year and gets you darn close to your half payback.
Right.
So as we haven't talked about today, but I've said it a lot, so we're going to open these stations with 20 trucks. Our job is to, over the next 6 to 8 months, do our damnedest to get 50 trucks. But you want to get 100 trucks. Mm-hmm. Now, sure, would I like to have 200 trucks, 300 trucks? Of course. But 100 trucks pays that station out in about a year.
Opens the doors.
Yeah. Well, right. I mean, pays the station out in a year.
Oh, great. Okay.
So, what's kind of comforting to me is I don't need 1,800 trucks and 68 different companies to make one truck stop.
Right. You need one customer.
I need one customer or three customers.
Right.
And so we have a long history of doing that. Mm-hmm. At LAX, we opened up that station with 500 gallons, I think, a day. We knew that we needed to get it to 1,000 gallons a day. And I think 1,000 gallons a day in those days got us a 3-year payback. Most businesses don't get a year payback on stuff. Mm-hmm. That got us about a 3-year payback on that station. Today we do 12,000 gallons at that station. So we have a lot of experiences of building stations and loading them.
And you know how the numbers work out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
That's pretty important. Let's shift a little bit and talk a little bit about something that we at the Motley Fool really look at closely, and we love it when co-founders and founders of businesses are still involved. We love it when we see insiders have a stake in the company.
Sure.
And historically, you had a trading plan in place that, you sold somewhere around 100,000 shares a year for a number of years. And then this past September changed dramatically. And since then, you've made a couple of purchases, invested $1.5 million of your own personal money on the free market to buy mm-hmm. shares of the company. What I'd like to hear you talk a little bit about is the difference between stock as part of your compensation and choosing to make an investment in the company, and what changed for you.
Sure. So I was the founder of the company, right? And I've been at it 17 years, and of course we went public in 2007. Mm-hmm. And you're right, I sold a couple hundred shares through there. You kind of wake up and all of a sudden you got 90 5% of your net worth
tied into one thing.
And you know, I don't know how smart that is. So I'd sold a couple hundred thousand shares. I've now
largely to diversify your
personal, a little bit. I mean, kids in college and all that, but I also diversified just a little bit. I still probably have 75% of my net worth in the company. So I guess since last, I don't know when it was, October, November, I've bought almost $1.8 million worth of stock at prices substantially higher than today. I stopped my 10B51 plan, whatever, however you pronounce that. I was really pleased to see the other day, and I just bought some here the other day as well, about $100,000 worth. I was pleased to see that we had three directors buy stock. Mm-hmm. John Harrington, a couple $100,000 worth, and our newest board member, and Vince Terramina. So, of course, Boone's never sold any stock. Mm. And in fact, last year he actually, you remember,
with the Chesapeake deal,
he acquired their notes. So he in effect put another $40-50 million in. So, mm-hmm. God bless him. He's never wavered and hasn't sold any stock. So, mm-hmm. I today have about almost 500,000 shares in the company. Our senior management team has done the same thing. Sometimes it's not real clear when you look at the filings, like our chief financial officer, he just exercised some options. Mm-hmm. But he didn't sell the stock. He kept the stock.
Right, kept
you got to pay the taxes and keep it. So, I like to see that commitment. And we have that up and down the ranks. We'd love to see the stock, move up. I think really, Jason, we talked about it before we started. We got to show volume growth, and we have to show that the trucks are being adopted. And, we can talk a lot, but that's really what it is you got to produce, and you have to show the volume growth.
Right, absolutely.
And that's where you got to come down.
And as a leader in a business, especially publicly traded, I can imagine at times it's a real challenge to remember that you have to focus on the business first, and the stock will follow if the business performs.
That's right. And, also, we're creating a whole new industry here. Mm-hmm. And we really have been doing that since day one. Had Boone not stayed committed and we not stayed focused, had we not done some of the things that we did early on, the natural gas vehicle industry in the United States would be gone.
Right.
And that really was because clean energy did it. And we proved out these different markets. This latest market is a tricky one, but it's a big one. And, it's kind of funny. The refuse sector is kind of compact. Mm-hmm. When you look at waste and Republican and those, they almost account for half of it.
Right.
The trucking one is much bigger target, but it's much more diverse. Mm-hmm. So it's a little bit harder to get your arms around. It'll take a little bit longer for it to develop, but it's much, much bigger. And, there's 3 million Class A trucks, 200,000 are sold every year in refuse. There's 8,000 trucks. So that's why we focus on it.
And they use a hell of a lot more fuel per truck.
And they use twice as much fuel. So it's the best market. Would we like it to move a little faster? Of course we would. We like the fact, I like to see guys buying hundreds and not 20s, but we know that they have to test this stuff. They're not going to go out and buy a brand new engine and bet the farm on it.
Pay a premium on it on top of that.
Pay a premium. I mean, the economics are still pretty good for them, but UPS, they've been at this a long time. Mm-hmm. We made our first UPS deal when I was at Mesa in, 1993 was some of their first brown vans on natural gas. They know natural gas. Mm-hmm. And that's why I think gave them more confidence to step up and buy, almost 1,000 of these trucks. So, but the others will get there, but they're going to test it. So we have to kind of go through this. It's frustrating for some, but we got to go through this period but I like to see when I see that we're working with 220 different fleets. We're getting better breadth, mm-hmm. not quite the numbers that we'd like. But we will, but they're going to go through the same. We saw the same exact thing in 2008, 2009 in the refuse business.
You want to talk a little bit about that? That as far as that, you've talked about it before on some of the calls, the transition from the small market share percentages.
In refuse, it started out in 2008. They wanted to test these trucks. They weren't convinced. And I think I mentioned it on this 3% in that first year, which was only 150 trucks. Mm-hmm. Then the next year kind of went to 7. And, of course, we were in a pretty bad economic cycle.
Right.
So guys weren't, everybody was scared to death and they weren't buying trash trucks. But what happened was then they got, they tried 10 and then they tried 30. And then they got to about 2000, 11 or 12, and it, all of a sudden you saw it pop up to 20, and then it went to 40 or 50, and then it went to 60.
Yeah, now it's the majority of trucks.
It's the majority of trucks, and it's trucks were and waste is at 95%. So it takes a while to get them comfortable, get all the guys on board,
right,
do all the facility, you know, modifications. But look, when you're saving somebody $1.50 a gallon or $1.70 a gallon, this isn't. It's one of the things I talk about. Remember, this isn't. We're not in here in the heavy duty trucking market trying to show something that we can save a penny a mile, or you know, a little niche here. This is $1.50 a gallon. And what is that? Well, that's almost 30 cents a mile. So it's real paradigm shift, and you're changing the way the fuel that this industry is going to use, and it doesn't happen overnight.
Right. Right.
But we kind of, I think, have the playbook in place with what happened with the refuse sector.
And you've seen it before, so you know
how it's going to play out. So we know how it's going to play out.
Absolutely. So let's talk a little bit about some milestones. What do you think is the most important milestone that clean energy will reach in 2014?
Well, we need to see truck adoption, right? And truck adoption will get you station opens. So if you were watching this closely and we never opened another station, that's a bad sign. and so that's just, and we're on that. We're very focused on it. We're incented around here as management to do that.
Right.
Of course, we can't make people buy trucks, but, you know, we're working really hard. And we're working through our GE Finance relationship. We're working with Chart on helping to buy down the price of the tanks. We're doing a lot of different things. We've just instituted a dealer program where we're working closely with guys that sell trucks.
Oh, interesting.
And, you know, that's how people buy trucks. They go to a truck dealer.
Right.
And so we're doing a lot of work with them. So I think we're putting a lot of the pieces in place. But for us, you just need to look at station openings and truck adoption. It's kind of hard to get those numbers exactly right, but that's, you need to see that happen.
Right.
I guess if there's a metric that, you know, important. I talked about volume before. You know, the nice thing is, I'm not sitting here saying I need. Gosh, if I can get 59,000 trucks, you know, or 5 million trucks, then I've done it. I mean, really, for us, we don't need that many. Mm-hmm. You could fill up this whole network right now with 5,000, 6,000 trucks. So it's not a ridiculous moonshot that we're trying to line up here. And as I take you back to 100 trucks makes a station have a 1 year payback. That's pretty easy to get your arms around.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So let's talk a little bit about better understanding, you know, how we can value clean energy and how we can understand the business. What is the most important thing people should know about clean energy?
Well, we're a fuel provider, right? So don't get lost in the trying to break down my, you know, if I'm selling some station, all that. I mean, you know, eventually this thing should be clear, right? Because the fuel, I mean, if I'm selling 1 billion gallons,
right,
that'll be pretty
obvious.
It becomes
the lion's share.
It's the lion's share. So, right. So it's been a little, people got a little lost for a while and a little BAF or, you know, this contribution, or if I sold stuff to customers. I mean, really, we're a fuel provider, so they ought to be thinking about us that way.
Okay.
And they're going to want to watch our market share. And, I wouldn't get completely obsessed with the CNG and LNG thing because we do both. And some people have assumed that LNG must have a lot better margin than CNG. That's not necessarily the case. Mm-hmm. So, in fact, in many cases, CNG's got better margin. So, I think those are the things that really do.
And nobody else has really made an effort to do both at this point. It's pretty.
No, I mean, we have a couple of competitors in the LNG business, and we have a whole bunch in the CNG business. But what we know is that you got to be able to serve the customer and serve them what they need, mm-hmm. right? That's why we know a lot about trucks.
Right.
We know a lot about finance. We finance trucks occasionally. We'll build you a station for your own account. We know a lot about compressors. We have our own cryogenic tanker fleet. We have our own LNG plants. And so I think that's proved out in the refuse space. I mean, there's a reason we have 75% market share.
Right.
Because other good competitors were in there knocking around us here over the last few years since mm-hmm. 2008. But I think, we have an educated force. We have we have 160 technicians that maintain this stuff. Mm-hmm. And, so you put all that together, I think it's kind of hard for some others to compete occasionally. A lot of people just don't have that.
Right. I think that's a fair statement to make. What is the most important thing that most people just don't get about the company that they miss?
Oh, I don't know. I think they get some people don't quite – well, I think some people don't understand the economics, the math around the fuel. So, you know, you'll have people say, oh, my God, natural gas has gone up a dollar. You know, there she goes. So they don't get that. So that I bring you back to that 8-to-1.
The economics of the fuel.
The economics of the fuel. I mean, you know, it'd be different if I was sitting here, Jason, and telling you, you know, I see this 10%, this 10-cent arbitrage. But it's a $2.50 arbitrage.
Right.
So I think people don't quite always understand that. And I'm not sure they understand our margins. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we try to show them that. We don't like to tell everybody everything, you know, because we're in a competitive situation. But our retail margins are pretty good. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I think our mix of business today, which is going to change over time, if we're right about this trucking, you're going to see a lot more of a shift to retail. We brought on, because I think we were good, we brought on a lot of transit volume at a low margin. But it's because we added 100 million gallons of low margin business, not because all of our margins were going
right,
up.
Right.
So I think those two things around the fuel. And I think there was a little bit of misunderstanding on CNG and LNG and just what sort of bet we made and how that's all going to work out.
Right. But as much as anything, that was just a matter of focus was taken away from people's perception.
And they don't know. And this is new business. And I think some conclusions are being drawn on pretty skinny data.
Right.
I mean, you know, to make some assumptions that one particular fuel or whatever is going to went out when you have
on essentially 90 days of sales. Of
90 days of sales on 2,000 trucks out of 3 million. I mean, wow. You know, we have to be careful on that.
Yeah, fair enough. I think that's fair. So we talked a little bit about it earlier, but it sounds like you're saying the most important metric to measure the company on is on volume of fuel growth.
That really is.
Yeah.
That's really what we should. We need to show that, mm-hmm. right? And so that's up to us, and we're really focused on that. So we do. It's really buying.
Yeah.
And then you're going to begin to see the kind of margins. Mm-hmm. So that would be the thing I focus on.
So in the broader media, I think the answer may be something we already talked about. But what's the biggest conception of the company that you see in the broader media?
Oh, of our company and the broader media, you know, that's an interesting question. I think what happens in sort of the broader media, and maybe not some of the people, you know, like yourself that really understand us and focus, they confuse the fleet business with the passenger. So, you know, if often tucked in an article, even in the Wall Street Journal someplace, it'll say, well, they're making progress, but there's 118,000 gasoline stations. So they, you know, most people, when they focus on this, they have their individual experience, passenger car experience, hat on.
Right.
And they're not really focused on the business that we're on. So the people kind of confuse that. So, yeah, if you look at 500 stations and you compare it to 118,000, that doesn't sound very good. When you take 500 stations compared to 5,000 diesel depots or so, mm-hmm. that's not so bad.
Right.
So I would say in the broader, and then I think there's a general confusion. We used to call it kind of alternative fuel du jour, right? So people kind of, they get confused. Electric, you know, Tesla's doing really good. So therefore that means that's going to be in an over-the-road truck. You know, so people don't understand some of the realities of energy.
Just because it has wheels and rolls on asphalt doesn't mean it's the same thing.
Fuel cells are going to really be good, so we'll just do that. So, you know, I think you're going to see, look, the Tesla and electric vehicles are really great for certain applications.
Right.
You got some work to do before they're ready to do a
trip. Moving 40,000 pounds
worth
of
80,000, right. Yeah. And so, and natural gas is really well suited for that. Mm-hmm. And may not be in the United States particularly well suited just because of the infrastructure and the scale on the light duty side.
Right.
I still think it is weird, though, that you have 62 makes and models in Europe of natural gas vehicles. You can get about anything you want, but here you have one.
Right.
So I'm not convinced that that's always has to be the case, because I think natural gas is going to be cheap. So I think there's a little bit of that confusion about just what fuels you have. You know, you'll have people say, well, propane could be the fuel. Well, no, propane can. I mean, propane's all right, but you can't. You don't have that much propane. And you don't have that much biodiesel. You just can't make that much of it. Mm-hmm. So natural gas is really one of the only fuels that has scale. Most people just don't quite understand that.
Right, right. Now that definitely makes sense. In closing, what would you like to leave our viewers with?
Well, just that you know, we're really focused. We're excited about the opportunity and the size of the market. We feel like we've assembled a good team, and we've spent some money to do it, right? And we've spent some money, we've staffed up in order to address this big market. We've always been the leaders in this business. We continue to be. This last heavy-duty trucking market really is the big enchilada, right? It's a huge market. So it's exciting, but it's required a lot of capital. I want your viewers to know that we're well-funded, that we're going to be careful with the capital, that we can afford the debt that we have in place, that we're very focused on our core markets that grow at about 20%, but we're also very focused on this big opportunity, and that we have the infrastructure in place. Our job is to open a bunch of it this year, and I feel like things are coming along pretty well.
Great, great. I think you're right. I think 2014 is definitely positioned to be the year of inflection.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of think that you've seen the tip. Mm-hmm. All right, now guys are testing it, but everybody gets it. You know, we don't go around arguing about whether or not you can use natural gas transportation anymore. Mm-hmm. And every fleet operator knows, and a lot of them are, you know, won't do anything else. This is the last market. It's going to take a little while. But I think we've already kind of been at the tipping point, and now it's just how fast does it go?
Makes sense. Thanks again for taking the time.
Thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
Absolutely appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, thanks for tuning in, everybody, and pull on.